If you would you sit back in your chairs? Let's take a few moments to work upon the health of our bodies. Let your eyes close, if you would, and just think along with me for a few moments. I turn away from the outer world that surrounds me to enter into the innermost world of my own mind, soul, and spirit. To focus in upon that great intelligence that exists within my body. The same God that created my body continues to live within me, to heal me, to restore me, to renew me whenever my body is in need. The very intelligence that is running all of the internal organs of my body, without any conscious effort on my part, is as an inner light within me. A light within me that, while within me, transcends me. A light that is all-powerful, that has created the stars and the heavens, has created life on earthly dimensions, and also other dimensions. The magnitude of this power that is within me is as large and as infinite as the universe itself. And so right here and right now, I align myself with this power, with this presence, knowing that this presence and this power knows exactly what my body needs to bring me to a state of peace and serenity, calmness and balance, polarity. And I open every cell of my body to the indwelling presence of this light, that it bathes me, soothes me, caresses me. And I feel the love of my Creator, loving my body with health, with renewal, with energy, healing whatever is in need of healing throughout my body. My body and its cells are made anew, renewed, reborn. And so all levels of my mind that can affect my body, cleansed, purified, cleansed of all that is in the past, purified, that purity may vibrate as health and well-being throughout my body, from the very top of my body to the very soles of my feet. The beauty, the peace, the goodness, the wholeness, the completeness exists throughout me. And my body is in a state of harmony with the greatest harmony of all, God's presence, God's beauty, God's wholeness. Is as a temple of God, and I dwell here within it in the presence of the Most High. Divine Father, Mother God, I give thanks for your presence and your wholeness. I let it be so, and so it is. Today we have an interesting subject dealing with psychic sight of the beyond. Now you can take that in many, many different ways, but there are ways that deal with life and reality, and a way that we come to gain knowledge that we might share with each other. For those of you that attend here on Sunday mornings, and for those of you that are watching all over the world, when I make statements, the statements are based upon research. The research is not limited to books. Books really are just a way of possibly rubber stamping what we have found over years of research. Close to a half a century ago, I began researching out expanded states of consciousness, because I had experienced many, many things in states of meditation, and curiosity got the best of me, and I was curious to see whether or not other people could experience the same things. And so in 1959, I started the Institute of Parapsychology. Now, parapsychology normally just deals with psychical research, but I wanted to take it a step further. I wanted to get into transpersonal psychology, which really deals with the innermost mysteries of the mind, of consciousness. And so what I did was to set up a research program that I would have people come in and take classes and courses in meditation and expansion of consciousness. And in the course of their doing this, I would keep very detailed reports on what they had experienced. These detailed reports over a period of a quarter of a century went into an enormous volume of experiences that people had had with their psychical senses. Things where they had seen things that go beyond the normal five sense range. And so when I share things with you, it is based not only upon a half a century of my own experiences in higher states of consciousness and meditation. It is based upon also research with literally tens of thousands of people that I have worked with over the years and kept track of what they were experiencing. Now, you must understand something, that the way that I approached this was not something like you might see in the popular books today, which says, you can be psychic, how to become psychic. Quite candidly, I really didn't care about a person becoming psychic or being a psychic. I really didn't. My thing was to explore consciousness, to find out what was the innermost reality behind life, behind the interaction of person to person. To be able to see those things which influence us on a physical level. And by just simply teaching people Eastern techniques of meditation, which got them into higher states of consciousness, their third eye or their psychic sight was awakened as a result of meditating upon trying to find the ultimate mystery of life. So it wasn't that then I taught them how to see auras or see clairvoyantly into other dimensions or to see departed spirits. That wasn't the reason. Psychic sight, as it came about within myself and within other people, was really in a search and the quest for higher God-like truth. When a person is seeking this, God's truth, the reality behind all of life. It is then as if the individual is safeguarded and protected, because the God presence within us will only reveal to us what our conscious mind is able to grasp. In the 60s, there were all types of hallucinogenics with LSD that opened up the trap doors of the mind and allowed people to have all kinds of psychic experiences or seen beyond their five senses. Those that were ready psychologically for this benefited. There were a number of psychologists that I knew at that particular time that were vastly influenced and had that influence carry with them over the rest of their lives, because they then saw that there were things beyond running mice through mazes. There were things that went beyond behavioral science as they had been taught and instructed. There was a dimension upon a dimension. And this particular dimension was something that was a whole different world to explore, a world that was far more vast than the physical world. And so, during this period of time, it concentrated in more upon this idea of the otherworldly. But it was for the otherworldly knowledge of self. And so the students, as we took them through them, we found out that there were trapdoors that maybe did not have the tremendous impact that a hallucinogenic might have to somebody that was not ready for such experience. But there were trapdoors in what I call psychic glamour. That is, a person can become trapped in having a perception of something. Maybe they start to see auras, as an example. Let's keep it very simple. And all of a sudden, that's all that they can think about, seeing auras. And so they buy every book and attend every class on how I can see an aura. And there are lots of techniques out there. But if a person then suddenly devotes themselves to being an auric reader, and that's the entirety of their life, and this, and it becomes blocked at that particular point, then they lose the spiritual. They lose the spiritual quest. So we can say, well, that's as far as that person was intended to go in this particular life. Or perhaps they have some type of a native psychic ability, and they feel that they can pick up on certain things, and so they set themselves up as somebody that deals with the paranormal or the psychic. But again, this is a diversion. It's a glamour type of situation. Again, we can say this is as far as this person was supposed to travel in this lifetime, just to get involved with a very basic lower psychic, what we call the lower astral level of this study. Now, I have always tried to push the envelope as far as people are concerned, to push them to their full potential. The full potential is union with God, mysticism. And so if a person's psychical sense opens up in the pursuit of God's presence, then it is knowledge added to that person. But it is not an end in itself. That a person has any type of thing that we could label a psychic ability is one thing, but it is only the first rungs of a ladder in the idea of becoming spiritually whole. Most people that get stuck on that particular level, you'll find, are just as neurotic and ill-equipped to face life as they were before these abilities, so-called, became manifest. I've seen this. I don't make these things up. And so what do you have? In the New Testament, it says the blind leading the blind. Now, we know what physical blindness is, and we could think of a physically blind person trying to take somebody and guide them across the busy street would be difficult. But let's suppose that you have a person that is mentally blind in the sense of trying to lead another person or giving another person advice. You see, whatever comes through the mind is filtered through the neurosis of the person giving the advice. Let me repeat that. Whatever advice is given comes through the neurosis energy of the person giving the advice. And so if that person is not a whole and complete person, then you can see that the advice is something that is suspect at best. It's very, very interesting. And people get trapped into this, either as the advice giver or the advice taker. It's a strange, strange thing that happens. There are certain people that will depend upon other people's so-called psychic abilities and call them up every day. They can't hardly make a move. Do you call this living? I call it death beyond death. And so the encouragement of psychic abilities for the sake of psychic abilities is a blind alley leading nowhere. The unfoldment of psychic perception in the pursuit of God is, as Christ said, seek first the kingdom of heaven and all else will be added unto you. Meaning all other knowledge will be added to you. Consider that. And if you do, you put then this whole subject of psychic perception or seeing the beyond into perspective. Without that, you run the risk of entering into a psychic glamour show, either as the giver or the taker. Either way, you are frozen in terms of your spiritual growth and your spiritual essence. That is, without a doubt, the way that people who pursue these areas of interest have to understand what they're getting into and where it can cause a bump in the road that can detour the person off the road. Now, having said that, let's turn to our affirmation sheet. And if those of you at home don't have an affirmation sheet, be aware that you can get one sent to you by email every week by going to www.metaphysics.com together with a preview of what we're going to be discussing. The first says Christian reference. Now, traditional and fundamentalist Christianity, while they will talk about all kinds of miracles, etc., etc., have something against anything dealing with the psychic. And that is erroneous, except, of course, if they see the types of people that are hung up on this lower end of the psychism that I just explained about. Now, if they see that, it's understandable where they could then be critical. But it says, I understand that reference to psychic sight, the third eye, or seeing beyond within, exists in the New Testament in the words, if thine eye be single, thy body shall be filled with light. Reference to a single eye. Now, in fundamentalist Christianity, they say take everything literally. Well, if we take that literally, it means we've got a third eye. If thine eye be single. Later on in the New Testament, Jesus says to his disciples that many of you that many people have sought to see these things which you have seen, but have not. Any of you recall that?
Yeah.
Many of you have sought to see these things, but have seen them not. That's a direct reference to seeing beyond. Here's another reference. Only the pure in heart shall see God. Notice the word see. Doesn't say think about God. Doesn't say feel God. It says see God. So if we take that literally, what do we have? We have then the idea that in the New Testament, Jesus is telling his disciples, you've seen things other people haven't seen, and if you're pure at heart, you'll see God. In the Bhagavad Gita, the Hindu gospel, I repeated this many, many times, there's a quotation that goes, though a man be filled with the sins of a lifetime, if he but love me, meaning God, in pure adoration, I see no sinner. That man is holy. That creates the purity of heart. If we love God beyond ourselves, if we love truth beyond ourselves, and truth and God and light are one, then we have followed the words, he who loses himself for my sake finds himself. And where do you find yourself? In the midst of light as light. You find yourself in the ultimate experience of universal presence or God. So the next affirmation says the end goal. It says, I understand that the end goal of paranormal sight is mystical union, or union with God. The end goal. So a person starts to meditate. The last lecture I gave was on chakras. The chakras begin to rumble and get into greater activity. A person begins to see things in their inner sight. They begin to perceive things that are beyond physical reality. But they are not daunted and taken away from their ultimate goal. Their ultimate goal is union with God. It is to know the ultimate. To know what this whole life is about. I'm sure that all of you that are here today and those of you that are watching have oftentimes questioned yourself, what is life really about? Generally, this comes about after we've had some type of traumatic experience in our life. Some type of trauma, some type of crisis, some type of disappointment. And we stop in midstream and we ask ourselves, what is all of this about? Well, the person that is pursuing the presence of the highest within themselves will intuitively, according to their ability to understand at that particular moment, be given a reason of why whatever took place, took place. And so there is a value to this knowledge. Wisdom, a wise philosopher once said, is its own reward. Wisdom is its own reward. Now, as you know, most people don't seek wisdom. They seek escapisms. Not having the answers to their life, being confused by the events of their life, they seek ways to escape the pain, the lack of understanding, and the confusion that they feel. And sometimes they get too wrapped up in it, and it becomes an addiction. And then eventually it destroys their life. That is why when you walk the spiritual path, you are not walking the psychic path. The psychic perception comes as a result of walking the spiritual path, but it in of itself is not an end of itself. Always bear that in mind. The Bhagavad Gita, once again, says even a mind that knows the path can stray from the path, for the senses are so unruly. But the seer recollects his mind and fixes it on me, meaning God, with him. I see a seer. That person is illumined. So then it comes to meditation. It says, I understand that I may have paranormal, visionary, or psychic sight perceptions as I move progressively towards mystical union. You see, as you're moving towards the ultimate experience, you'll have lesser experiences. You'll begin to see into other dimensions. You'll begin to see various things, which is another affirmation upcoming. But that isn't your goal. Your goal isn't astral projection. Your goal isn't telepathic communication. Your goal certainly isn't to control other people. Your goal is the aspiration towards enlightenment, towards wisdom, towards knowledge. And that's why it says, again, I understand that I may have paranormal, visionary, or psychic sight perceptions as I move progressively towards mystical union. You're meditating every day, and every day that you meditate, your inner sight may open up and you may see something that is beyond the physical. And it's interesting. You gain knowledge. You gain knowledge that, first of all, you're going to go on, because you gain knowledge that other dimensions exist. And if you happen to spontaneously astrally project your astral body into one of these dimensions, you gain knowledge, hey, this is the way it works. So when I'm ready to go, I just pop in to another dimension. I have a secondary energy body, I call my astral body, I just pop in. But this isn't what you're looking for. This isn't your end goal. Your end goal is mystical union. If I had every one of you as a live-in monastery type of person, and the universe assigned me to try to help you along this pathway, I would be on top of you every day saying to you, don't get diverted by what you experienced. We'll talk about it, we'll understand it, but don't get it, don't let it divert you. There's a lot more to you than these lower rungs of psychic perception. So that's why next it says diversionary. It says, I understand that while some paranormal sight experiences have a fascination connected to them, I will not become diverted by them for my end goal or mystical union with God. Yes, these things are fascinating. I know when I experienced them, I found them fascinating. I know students that I had over the years, when they experienced these psychic perceptions of otherworldly things, they found them fascinating. Can't help but find it fascinating. But don't make a lifestyle out of it. Don't get hung up on the psychic ladder. The ladder that leads upward leads to God. It doesn't lead to lower perception. Lower perception are just steps on the way to perhaps prepare you for the ultimate experience. Sight, there are various stages of what you see and perceive. It says, I understand that paranormal sight perception generally starts in the forehead area, That is, with your eyes closed, the interior region of the forehead becomes like a viewing screen. Then the entire inner head area, it extends the screen. It's like you start with a little 3-inch screen, perhaps up in the forehead area, and then you enlarge the screen area to the whole interior of the head area. So then it possibly becomes like an 8 or 9-inch screen that you're viewing. And you're seeing, this third eye or inner sight is seeing. Now, there's nothing really that complicated about it, because actually it doesn't really insult physical, empirical thought, in the sense that they have come to the conclusion that the mind is the only true organ of sight anyway. So what are we doing? We're cutting off sense perceptions being fed in from the outside, and that energy that we normally use for physical sight has now been transferred to a different frequency and different mental frequency, and we're tuned into that frequency and we're seeing in that frequency. It's like changing channels on your television set. A picture appears on your television set with different frequencies. A picture appears in the interior region in our single eye area, in our mind's eye, by changing frequencies. Then it says, next to the interior of the body or the reproductive area. The visionary screen then, once again, three stages. Forehead, first stage, whole interior of the head area, second stage, entirety of the body down to the reproductive area, third stage. At all times, you retain a sense of individuality. It is like you are seeing something. That's what in this study we call the I-thou relationship. You are a perceiver, perceiving something apart from your sense of individuality. That is in the psychic level of perception. And finally, in mystical union, where there is no sense of physical body, only infinite God light presence. That is mystical union. That is what Jesus meant when he said, I am one with God. In our innermost essence, all of us are one with the ultimate. We came from it, and in fact, we've never left it. That's the real awakening, once a person resumes their individualized situation, once they have had the mystical experience and they're now no longer having it. The after effect is to realize that all of my life is lived in oneness with this light, and that's all it really is. So it says next, experiences. I understand that paranormal sight experience may vary greatly, some of which may include vibrant colors, energy patterns, vortexes, symbols, gods or goddess images, architecture, religious symbols of various religions, etc., etc. One of the things that I found most interesting, because I approach this as an independent. When I was doing research for about a quarter of a century, I approached this totally as an independent. I didn't approach it from a Christian standpoint, I didn't approach it from a Hindu standpoint, from a Buddhist standpoint. I approached it as the exploration of consciousness. It's like politically in this country, you're neither a Republican or a Democrat, you're an independent. So I had no bones to grind, no axes to grind. I was a researcher trying to find out what really was and is. The interesting part about it was that I found in these lesser perceptions, these psychic perceptions, I found that there was a basis in higher levels of consciousness of all of the major religions. That all of them had their heavenly worlds and their celestial realms, etc., etc. And it was quite an awakening for me. And I confirmed this over a period of time with all of the different students that I have. They were seeing things. They might have been brought up as a Christian, but they were seeing Buddha. They were seeing Krishna. They were seeing symbols that were non-Christian and non-Judaic. And so, one might say, there's a law of physics that says something can't come from nothing. And if in this expanded state of consciousness and awareness, all of these things, the basis of all the religions, exist, then there has to be a reason that there is a foundation on another level of consciousness that saints, seers, prophets, messiahs tap into, and that those basic archetypal images are funneled through and channeled through and become what we call a religion. Of course, the religion is a vague shadow of what the person has really perceived. It is just barely hinting. And that's why Jesus had to talk in parables, because it's too profound to go into when the mind simply blanks out to whatever you're describing. Now, the things I have down here under experiences are just sketchy as far as what a person can experience. I've taken and put down there most of the things that are quite common as far as experiences are concerned. To be able to see with your third eye, or be able to see with the eye of the soul into other dimensions. It's very, very interesting. I have down there architecture as an example. Extremely, extremely, extremely interesting when it comes to architecture. Because you begin to see how some of the architecture that we have here precedes the architecture as it appeared on Earth. I remember, it was maybe about 15, 20 years ago, I was going through a Sunday newspaper in one of their magazine sections. And they had sketches there of a French architect that lived in the 17th century. The sketches that he had down there as far as architecture was concerned, now mind you, this was about 20 years ago I saw this, were far in advance as far as what we would call modern and contemporary of what we have today. When I've gone into states of meditation, I'll see psychic things, but I'll see architecture perhaps that relates to other cultures. And some of this architecture will relate to temples, it will relate to places of worship. And I'll see this architecture and I'll recognize the vastness of God's consciousness that has allowed all of these religions to become manifest on a physical plane, but in fact have their basis and their origin in higher levels of consciousness. Now again, I could get hung up for the rest of my life just pursuing what I just told you, just a smidget of what a person could experience. I could have gotten hung up on celestial architecture. But there's the drive inside to reach the ultimate. Now, when a person has these experiences as they're meditating, again, I emphasize as they're meditating for the purpose of union with God, not because they have read some book on how to be a psychic, but because they come about as a natural result of meditation with the pursuit of utter truth, absolute truth, or God. When a person has the perception, it says eyes open or closed. It says, I understand that most paranormal sight perceptions is seen inwardly, but may also be seen with physical eyes open if mind contact has been made. All that really means is that your eyes are like lenses of a motion picture camera that are projecting out onto the panorama of your environment what you're seeing inwardly. In other words, if you close your eyes, you'll see the same thing inwardly. Having made mental contact, you open your eyes and the perception continues outwardly. It's superimposed on your physical environment. Then what I alluded to a little bit ago, where it says, I, thou. It says, I understand that in paranormal psychic sight perception that I retain my sense of individuality from what I am perceiving, or an I-thou relationship. That's important to understand. It also emphasizes why we go for the ultimate or the absolute experience, why we go for mystical experience. Because as long as you have an I-thou relationship, you are a house divided against itself. The proverbial house divided against itself. You still have an I-thou relationship. It's still you is one thing and something else is something else. So there is still a duality, still a sense of separateness. And when you have a sense of separateness, there is then the possibility of backsliding into some type of neurotic pattern or losing everything that you've gained spiritually and having difficulty at that point to regain it. Mystical union, on the other hand, I understand that in mystical union with God, all sense of I-thou is non-existent, and there is only oneness with God's light. So to recap, what have I really said here this morning? I have said that psychic sight exists. It's a natural part of our awakening to who and what we are. It should be not pursued, but should come in the context of the pursuit of God. If it comes in the context of the pursuit of God, where we're not trying to force perception, perception will be made available to you in a safe and natural way. So many of you that are connected with metaphysical pursuits are so involved with always doing the natural thing. Natural vitamins, alternative medicine, natural this, natural that. Well, wouldn't it make sense that if it's something unnatural, like a drug, it will have its side effects? If you try to force something, there's a thing that Jesus said in the New Testament, very seldom, if ever, stated in any traditional Christian church. Because you'd have to understand it within the context of the things I'm talking about. He said, you cannot take the kingdom of heaven by force. It's in the New Testament. Any of you remember that? You cannot take the kingdom of heaven by force. So when you try to use all kinds of techniques, whether they be hallucinogenic drugs, whether they be all types of different exercises and so forth, you are trying to force the issue. You are trying to force the doors of perception open. And while you'll get inklings and so forth, unless you're cleared up and ready for that, which only the presence of God inside of you knows, then you'll get hung up on a particular level of psychic sight, and you'll become another neurotic psychic. I'm telling you as it is. And of course, this does not make me popular in terms of the overall metaphysical field, which oftentimes prostitutes itself to all types of psychic goodies. But my purpose in sharing with people is to bring out the greatest potential within the individual, which is not their psychic sight. by which is their oneness with the ultimate and the absolute presence of deity or God within themselves. Seek ye first the kingdom of heaven. Seek ye not first to be a psychic. You didn't see that in the New Testament, did you? Wake up, people. Wake up to that which is real inside of you. All these goodies, all the goodie bags, all these things that deal with psychic perception and so forth, they'll be added to you as you go along, but they'll be added safely, and they will not hang you up and keep you frozen to one level of awakening in this lifetime. I hope I've made this whole subject clear. Obviously, we can spend hours going into the details of psychic perception and what a person will experience. What I feel is far more important is the philosophy, the psychology behind what all of this means in the overall scope of each of your lives. How much better off you'll be. And if you take it within the total context and framework of your spiritual pathway to God, then whatever I've said here this morning will ring true. And I hope that those of you that are here and those of you that are watching at home will review this, perhaps on a DVD that you send for, or if you want to review it, it'll be available for those of you watching at home and those of you that are here and want to go home and watch it for 24 hours, beginning at 1 p.m. today, Sunday, through to 1 p.m. tomorrow on Monday, that specific time, or minus 8 hours GMT. All right, having said all of this, now it's time to meditate. So I'm going to ask if you would you sit back in your chairs, put both feet flat on the floor, or your ankles crossed, whichever is most comfortable to you, and we'll take a few moments to enter into a state of meditation. I turn away from the outer world that surrounds me, turn my mind in upon itself, turn the energies of outer perception inward, that I may see with the eye of my soul, my inner quest towards the light that is the all in me, that is the all of the universe. I shut off the doors of outer perception for a few moments, that the doors of inner perception may be open to me, that I may see and catch a glimpse of a greater reality, a portion of the kingdom of heaven within. As God leads me upward to my quest for union with God, every breath that I breathe into my body fans the flame of my aspiration to be one, to feel God, to know God, to enter into God's light and not be able to distinguish myself from that light, that I may be in oneness with the light, oneness with God. And so I move to a greater awakening, for my object is God and God alone. I seek the light. I move towards the light, and God within me is my guide, opening before me whatever I am prepared to see, to view, to be one with. Recline back into the light. I am that which I am. Sit for a few moments, sensing, feeling a greater reality that is within me. In a few moments, my eyes and my senses will open to the exterior world once again. But I will continue to be under the influence of the inner world of God's presence within me. And so now, ever so slowly, I'll begin to open my eyes and my senses once again to the exterior world. Ever so slowly. And as I do, I'll bring my arms and my hands upward, high over my head in a symbolic gesture of always reaching for something higher in my life, knowing that that something higher that I reach for is to be found in the height of who and what I truly am within myself, a living, breathing manifestation of the stars and of the heavens, having taken image, shape, form, and embodiment. And I bring down my hands, resting in the peace, the security, that this is so. And so it is.